In this segment of the Neural Integration Lecture Series, you will learn about the ionic basis of an action potential. And so the goal is to view how a neuron generates an electrical signal and how that signal can be propagated down the neuron. So like I mentioned earlier, we've already discussed that dendrites can generate graded potentials, cell bodies can generate graded potentials, and if those graded potentials reach the axon hillock, where I've put an X, then we can generate an action potential. So before we begin, you should know some definitions and some terminology in order to understand the phases of the action potential. And so on this graph, you have the membrane potential on the y-axis. If we use a term called depolarization, that means your membrane potential has become more positive, or you can say less negative, than rest, or than the resting membrane potential. Remember that the resting membrane potential of a neuron is negative 70 millivolts. Repolarization means the membrane has become more negative until it's reached negative 70 millivolts. Repolarization is over once the membrane reaches rest. Then we have hyperpolarization. Hyperpolarization tells us that the membrane potential is more negative than the resting membrane potential. So these are three very important terms that we will be using throughout this series of notes. So with types of potential changes, we have two different types. You're already familiar with graded potentials. And then we also have action potentials. So just so that you understand, once again, the connection between graded potentials and action potentials, you have to have a graded potential, and it has to get the membrane potential to negative 55 millivolts in order to generate that action potential. So threshold is negative 55 millivolts. Be sure that you know that number. Be sure you know resting membrane potential is negative 70 millivolts. And remember that this process is occurring on the cell body and the dendrites. Once that graded potential reaches the axon hillock and the membrane potential is negative 55 millivolts, an action potential will occur. Action potentials are all or none. They either happen or they don't. So with the action potential, you have three different phases. You have the depolarization phase, you have the repolarization phase, and we have hyperpolarization. Now this is a very dynamic process, and so it's very important to understand when we explain this, I can only explain it in terms of the channel being open or the channel being closed. However, it's very dynamic. So we'll begin here with our membrane at rest. So negative 70 millivolts. So the figure on the bottom left is showing you your graded potential with respect to the action potential and how the two of them go together. And so the numbers, the red numbers illustrated on the graph, will correspond to the large number at the top of your screen. So we're beginning at rest, number 7. Okay, now at rest, we know what our ion concentrations are in the intracellular fluid as well as the extracellular fluid for both potassium and sodium. Now at rest, let's look at the configuration of the gates, of the voltage-gated ion channels. So remember that these ion channels, these voltage-gated sodium and potassium ion channels, are located at the axon hillock and on the axon. So when we look at the voltage-gated sodium channel. Remember, we have the two gates. At rest, the sodium activation gate is closed and the inactivation gate is open. And you can see that in the diagram. The voltage-gated potassium channel is closed. So at rest, is there any net movement of potassium or sodium through a voltage-gated ion channel? You should have answered no, because both channels are closed. You will note that when the voltage-gated sodium activation gate is closed and the inactivation gate is open, this is the closed but capable of opening configuration. This neuron at this point, when the channels, the sodium channels are in this configuration, that's important. Doesn't have to be at rest necessarily, but when the ion channels are in this configuration, this neuron is capable of responding to a stimulus. That is very important. Now, the other graph on the far right is illustrating the membrane permeabilities to you for both the potassium and sodium ions. and they're showing that membrane permeability with respect to the phases of your action potential. So for example, during depolarization, there's a high membrane permeability for sodium and a decreasing membrane permeability for sodium during repolarization. So we'll assume that a stimulus has been applied and an excitatory graded potential, or an EPSP, has occurred. The stimulus had to have been applied where? If we generated an EPSP, what part of the neuron would the EPSP be generated on? So it's a graded potential. Hopefully you said cell body and dendrites. And the stimulus must be excitatory. And the reason we say it must be excitatory is if you look at this graded potential here, the membrane potential is more positive. And when the membrane potential is more positive, we say that that is an excitatory stimulus because it made the membrane potential more positive. So we're assuming threshold stimulus occurred. So the stimulus was strong enough to get the membrane potential to negative 55 millivolts at the axon hillock. And now we have an action potential that occurs. You need to understand what's happening to the membrane potential during each of the phases. Is the membrane potential becoming more positive, more negative? And how does that depend on the voltage-gated ion channels? So if the voltage-gated ion channels are open, how does that change the membrane potential? Or if they're closed, does it change the membrane potential? And what is the current, meaning the permeability for sodium and potassium, through those voltage-gated channels? Remember that ions like potassium and sodium can only be permeable if their voltage-gated channels are open. What causes the voltage-gated channels to open? And so the answer to that is a change in the membrane potential. And then lastly, if a voltage-gated channel is open and the current is zero, so let's think about that. There's a channel that's open, but there's no ion movement through that channel. So as we go through the notes and in lab as well, you'll be understanding that concept. I am going to stop here and then we will do a part two series for this set of notes.